So while everybody is settling down, just wanted to get an idea of the audience. How many of you are actually core blockchain technology people, means whose interest is in architecture, platform, et cetera? Okay. How many from banking or capital markets in general whose interest is in banking and capital markets as such? And how many understand securitization process really well? Great. Okay, so it's a tough ask. I don't know. The session is 10 minutes, right? So talk about securitization and get into the platform. So I'll talk about securitization for a minute so that everybody is kind of on the same page, and then we'll get to, means how does blockchain help securitization, and then a quick demo of what we are doing. So people who understand securitization, please excuse me for this oversimplification. But securitization is necessary because somebody has surplus money to invest, somebody needs to borrow money to buy a house, and you need to connect these two monies in some ways. Now, unfortunately, what happens is that this money, which is somebody's pension investment, is turned into somebody's borrowing for a house through a very, very complex, multi-layered process, which involves, means it's probably one of the few processes or transactions in the financial services industry, which involves every player in the financial services industry. Banks, investment banks, insurance companies, et cetera, et cetera. So any player in the financial services industry is involved. When I said this, this is how it happens. Some countries are different. So China, India, for example, have very high savings rate. And there, for example, people will just deposit into this bank and the bank will lend. So none of this is really required in the same scale as it would be required in the US. So the bank takes so much deposit, it can just lend that out. So you don't need as much of securitization. This market came to a standstill or was virtually dead because this is what led to the 2008 financial crisis. But the market has recovered to the same levels as 2008. It has not only recovered. For example, I gave you the example of India, where it is just shooting through the roof now because the deposit rates are dropping significantly. And hence, addressing how securitization gets done is absolutely critical, right? But like all things in financial services industry, this is a process where there is a big trade-off between risk and efficiency. So if you try to put a lot of additional compliances, controls, et cetera, the efficiency drops. And actually, securitization is worse because here, it is not only a difficult trade-off. Actually, with every additional step which is added in the securitization transaction, which is the trustee coming in, the rating agency coming in, everybody is adding a layer of cost, but reducing transparency. So normally what would happen if you improve efficiency, risk would increase or risk management would, mitigation would drop and vice versa. In this case, it's a double whammy. The efficiency is dropping and the risk is increasing. So this is how the problem statement is, that between the investor and the issuer, there are just so many layers that if you think of 2008, let's say Florida real estate market crashes in February, March, continues to crash. After 3-4 layers, there is somebody holding a derivative who even in August thinks he or she is sitting pretty. It's again an oversimplification, but that's information asymmetry. There's layering of costs because so many intermediaries are getting involved. Portfolios do get rated by rating agency, Moody's, Standard and Poor's, etc. But they get rated when the transaction is happening. So if a transaction is happening in Feb, the portfolio will get rated then. After that, if the whole market has completely changed in the next 3-4 months, the portfolio is not continuously getting re-rated. And every single securitization transaction is a long one-on-one negotiation. So if you went to a securitization conference, 50-60% of the participants would be lawyers. That is how one-on-one negotiated, contracted this industry is. Now, in this context of the problem statement, how is blockchain a solution? This is not our copyright. It's a Deloitte paper that I've extracted. So what it does is simply one version of truth. So the fact that almost every player in the financial services industry is involved, and because of being on blockchain, every one of those players has a single view of what the transaction and what the data is. Comprehensive tamper-proof audit trail. Everybody is a blockchain audience. No need to explain. Efficient market, better valuation and price discovery. So if you get multiple issuers and multiple investors onto a platform, you can bring much greater benchmarking and visibility than this completely isolated one-on-one transactions. Speed and certainty, that's something when I do the demo, I'll just show it to you. Now, what we are doing in this is, we are combining the power of artificial intelligence on a blockchain platform so that we can automate a lot of things using AI and then use blockchain's ability to create additional trust. I'll just do the demo. So just to make the demo simple, I have taken three individuals here. Means there are multiple parties on the platform, but Alice is an originator. There are people who have given the loans. They own the loans. Bob is an issuer who's packaging these loans and selling it to the investor. And Mike is an investor. I had a servicer as well, but it was also a male name. I didn't want to have a 3-1 proportion when I was doing the demo. So I just thought I'll let it be. So let's say I log in as Alice. What we do is we use artificial intelligence to actually directly read the loan contract and verify the data before we upload onto the blockchain. Because otherwise the argument will always be that everything on blockchain is great and perfect, immutable, etc. But when you are taking the data in, you are taking the data from the originator as it is and you are trusting it. So what's the value of doing it on blockchain? So I'm really worried about the, so I'm just taking one loan contract and meanwhile I'll try to demo the other features to you. Okay. Now forget about the blockchain. The reason we have spent like 30 developers, 7-8 months is that even if you ignore there is a blockchain underneath, as an enterprise solution, it should be the best enterprise solution possible in the industry. So now think of it from Alice's point of view, who's the originator. She can create the pool here. She can set up the whole pool of what she's trying to sell. Then she can transfer the pool of loans to the issuer, and all the loan details will be available to her. So see, for example, this loan contract has been completely read here. Say vehicle loans today. So basically, means as an enterprise application, everything possible that has to be done can be done on this platform. It'll just take time to load the loans. And then I can do the due diligence on this as itself. Because what I have done is, what is involved in a due diligence? Somebody physically takes 5-6% of the samples in a securitized portfolio, goes through each of those, and then matches it against the data that has been offered to you. Now, what we are doing is, we have taken the data that has been offered to us, but we have run our AI engine on 100% of those loans. So, for example, the actual production transaction with which we went into production at about 4,000 loans. Our engine has read every single one of those 4,000 loan contracts, brought the data, matched it against the database, and then it's coming on to the thing. And now because the pool is selected to whom I want to transfer is done, and then let me just log in as Bob, who's the issuer. So Bob now has multiple pools, which he would have had earlier. As the issuer, he has complete repayment details. This is the detail of his SPV. For people who are familiar, what is done is if there are 4,000 loans, they are divided into multiple categories based on the risk profile of those loans, which is called tranching. And different tranches can be created. So for example, class A, class B, class C, so a very high risk-oriented investor looking for high returns would pick a different tranche. So all that creation of tranches can also be done by the issuer when he's selling that portfolio. Now we get to Mike, who's the investor. An investor has complete details of the transaction, can agree to buying or not buying a portfolio. And let me see if I have, Now, what additionally investor has is, because we are running an AI engine on all the loans. So first advantage that we have is everybody has exactly the same view of all the loans. So you, the investor not only knows about his portfolio, he can drill into his portfolio, know about every single loan. And within every single loan, So within every single loan, he gets details of every detail about that loan, including collaterals, payment details, somebody missed a payment, et cetera. And that is allowing us to run the AI engine to do forecasting of the portfolio if that investment is worth it or not, right? So this is giving us an ability that almost like a stock exchange ticker. So just imagine Lehman Brothers in 2007, 2008, had like an NYSE ticker in front of them, which in real time is telling them that how their portfolio is moving. And again, means I'm oversimplifying, so people who are experts in the industry don't go curse me about this. But that is the ability we are bringing because now I have data on the blockchain. And that's our general principle in how we are going about this development, which is that at two places, AI substantially helps blockchain solutions. First is here, which is when we are onboarding. So the on-blockchain and off-blockchain interaction, you can significantly automate using AI. We use our AI engine. Then because we are structuring the whole transaction online, we are able to reduce the transaction, creation of transaction, which is currently 6 to 8 weeks, by about 50%. I showed you, we can do a real-time rating of the portfolio. So almost like a stock exchange ticker, you're seeing the portfolio. Auto execution of contractual terms through chain codes or smart contracts. So for example, contracts have clauses like if the default rate goes above 5%, 2% additional collateral needs to be brought in. Actual situation in the industry is that at the end of the month, a reporting gets done, which takes 10, 12 days just to reconcile and people to agree to a report. So there would be issuers and investors in the industry today on 12th of December who today would be negotiating and coming to an agreement on transaction which actually happened on 1st of November, right? Because the November end report would have been published. So that's the situation. And we are basically now not only agreeing to the data, but contractual terms which have to be executed on based of that data can be executed. The benefit is that hopefully the person raising capital can raise capital at 40, 50 basis points lower cost of capital because the transaction costs are lower and the risk is lower. And the investor actually can get a much better risk return because of complete transparency. So if you actually shave off between the cost of risk and the cost of transaction, 70, 80 basis points in an ideal world, if 30, 40 basis points get split between the two, both the issuer or the and the investor are benefiting from that, right? This is what we don't do. So one confusion a lot of people have, we don't originate loans on the platform. The loans get originated. Origination means the loans are given by banks the way they are given today. The contract of that loan, which is now an asset, we take that asset, pool it, and securitize it. So the origination of loans is what we don't do on the platform. There's our roadmap. we have put into production a 4,000 loan portfolio. We have just set up a US entity. There are a couple of different asset classes in which we are executing projects now. One thing which is on the horizon for us is, can we create tokens out of the securities? Because currently we are not tokenizing these securities. Anil, you want to comment on the architecture? Maybe we can spend a couple of minutes.
Yeah, we have logically it is a three-tier architecture, but it in effect will can be an entire architecture. So we have the blockchain topography here. The blockchain topography is right now hosted on Google Cloud for the vehicle loans company for whom we have done the product and which is in production. So we are using a Google VPC, and all our peers and orgs, all the peer nodes and the orderer nodes are all sitting on Google VPC. And we use, right now with this version of the software, we use Fabric's CLI tool. On top of it, we have written a layer, a web layer, which basically where we handle all the validation, client-side validation. Many of the validations, say for example, if we are going to validate whether a loan is not allocated to different pools, so we have embedded that into the chain code. Our chain codes are all written in Golang. So that is the architecture that we have, and our AI basically uses certain web services, which again we have created on top of the CLI tool. It consumes that, and it interacts with the blockchain by way of cron jobs. We run cron jobs. AI engine interacts with the cron jobs, and the cron jobs.
So just in terms of some of the technology choices we made, we actually, because Fabric is written in Golang, we decided to code in Golang, even though scarcity of resources, etc. We can have a discussion on some of these things offline, because I guess we have run out of our time. I can take any questions on this. Otherwise, the presentation is there, uploaded. Any additional information, you can shoot out a mail to us, or on the Socio app, you can connect with me or Anil. We can answer your questions, what we cannot answer here in-house, and any detailed architecture decision or demos, et cetera, that you want, we can have subsequently.